What is the fascination of heritage railways? Well, we come from a generation which considered train spotters rather odd, if they considered them at all, as people huddled at the end of the station platform as we headed out to party in London were a byword for boring. But we also come from a generation that knew Britain's railways before Beeching slashed the network to ribbons in the 1960s, slating 2,360-odd stations for closure along with 5,000 miles of track, and the generation which travelled behind the last steam locomotives before they were withdrawn from service in 1968. Now, despite the distant memories of childhood railways, our interest in rail was limited over most of the last few decades to complaining about post-privatisation fares, along with some gentle nostalgia and romanticism. So how is it that now we're the owners of a year-long freedom pass on the Severn Valley Railway, giving us the ability to ride behind these noisy, smoky, dusty trains of great vintage every day of the year if we so choose? It's true that the sights and sounds of a steam train can swiftly transport us back in time, make us feel connected to history, and history has long been a bit of an obsession for us, so that's part of the picture. And speaking of pictures, there are few things so impressive on screen as a big old train. And a lifetime of writing, filming, telling stories that explain events to other people makes them creatively irresistible. Steam trains are, after all, marvels of engineering with intricate designs, powerful engines that were well ahead of their time. They represent an era when machines were built with precision and craftsmanship, and their sheer size and complexity is awe-inspiring. And even on a 16-mile-long heritage line, it's a bit of an adventure. The idea of embarking on a journey on a steam train can be an exciting prospect. The slow, steady pace of the train allows for a more leisurely and immersive travelling experience, which can be a welcome change, especially if you've just come off the motorway, and particularly because these trains rarely exercise their full potential, except when perhaps attacking an incline. But it's the visual appeal, the shiny metal surfaces, whistling steam and well-oiled rods and pinions, whatever they are, driving the wheels. This is a testament to human ingenuity and the beauty that can be found in machinery. Then there's the line itself, 16 miles of very rural English countryside, with a line running beside the twisting River Severn through hamlets, villages and small towns, which are themselves often honeypots for visitors looking for country walks, wildlife, a nice country pub for lunch and views over the River Severn or the Wye Forest, and perhaps the impressive Victoria Bridge across the river, built back in 1861. And along this line, there's even an opportunity to spot more exotic wildlife as it runs alongside the West Midlands Safari Park near Bewdley for a short time. Now, this railway was originally built in 1862 to connect the Midlands with the southwest of England, from Shrewsbury down to Worcester, but it was closed in the 1960s as a result of those Beeching cuts. It swiftly became one of the earlier heritage railways, reopening in 1970 with a collection of steam locomotives and carriages that had been preserved by the society. And over the years, the railway has expanded and now features a wide range of locos and rolling stock of all sorts. Another highlight of the Severn Valley Railway is those collection of historic stations. The line features six of them in all, each of which has been restored to its former glory and offers a glimpse into the past. From the charming Kidderminster Town Station to the elegant Bridgnorth Station, each is a testament to the history of the line and the dedication of the volunteers who've worked to preserve it. Today, the Severn Valley Railway is one of the most popular heritage railways in the UK, attracting over 250,000 visitors a year before COVID, but now facing an uncertain future, unfortunately. The Heritage Railway is appealing for £1.5 million for what it describes as a survival fund. The railway is facing rising costs and falling visitor numbers, and it's seen its electricity bill double to nearly £500,000 in the last 12 months alone, while visitor numbers have dropped by about a third in that time. Company bosses say other costs have also spiralled, including coal, diesel, steel, copper, catering supplies, interest rates, of course, and all that's beyond the railway's control. Jonathan Dunster, the railway's interim MD, said it could be at risk unless there was an urgent injection of cash. There is a positive note, a busy steam gala weekend and nearly £70,000 flowing into the appeal funds within days has brought a note of optimism. The SVR, as it's known, continues to operate as a non-profit organisation staffed largely by volunteers who are passionate about preserving the history of the line and sharing it with the public. And that's part of the attraction for us too, because this is a railway company genuinely interested in being a railway rather than primarily concerned with increasing the dividends paid out to shareholders, as is the case on much of Britain's mainline network. That dedication is self-evident in the small details, the way the carriages are kept as accurate representations of their era, including some remarkable wooden ones with gleaming varnish, and the wonderfully functional guards vans, as well as the wide variety of locomotives, both native and borrowed for special occasions. And it's even more evident when you interact with the staff, whether they're volunteers or employees, who are not only proud of their hard-won knowledge, experience and competence in running this historic system, but they're also keen to make visitors a part of their rattling, hissing, oily, slightly smutty in the best sense of the word, world. And the SVR, like many other heritage railways, is a little world, separate from modern reality, if not immune to the pressures imposed by incompetent governments and world events. You enter that world the moment you step onto the station concourse at Kidderminster, with its refreshment room, just like the old ones, and the kiosks may not be selling cigarettes or newspapers these days, but they look the part, as do the sack barrows and the wheeled trolleys still in use around the station. At the other end of the line, Bridgnorth Station sits perfectly in period, looking up at the town's castle mound and down to the River Severn below, with sidings and sheds alongside one of the platforms, bustling with the work of feeding the hungry locomotives and keeping them in good repair. There's a welcome breakfast in the Bridgnorth refreshment room and a station pub. And all along the line are picture-perfect rural stations and halts, each one a film set in its own right. At some stage, the SVR must have bought a job lot of redundant milk churns, as every station seems to have half a dozen or so, waiting to be collected by the morning milk train you imagine to be shipped into the urban dairies of the industrial Midlands and the Black Country. Every aspect of the history of the railways is available here, even the ephemera and paraphernalia of bygone times. At Kidderminster Station, set off to one side and not technically part of the SVR, is a delightful little museum dedicated to those bits and pieces. Old signs and nameplates, telephone systems, boundary markers and lots of signalling gear, along with items only an expert could name, quite frankly, but providing an insight into the engineering mindset of railway people for whom the detail is what makes it all work. And next door to the delightfully rural Highley Station, the Engine House Museum for the Severn Valley Railway is built on the site of the former Highley mine sidings, although you'd never know that this area was once a busy mining area. The museum itself is impressive, with several historic locomotives sitting on the twin line of tracks linking the building to the railway itself. And as well as a former royal carriage, there's a fascinating royal mail coach from the days of John Betjeman's Night Mail, the days when trains carried sorters sifting through letters of thanks, letters from banks, letters of joy from girl and boy, receipted bills and invitations to inspect new stock or to visit relations, and applications for situations, and timid lovers' declarations and gossip, gossip from all the nations, news circumstantial, news financial, letters with holiday snaps to enlarge in, letters with faces scrawled on the margin, letters from uncles, cousins and aunts, letters to Scotland from the south of France, letters of condolence to highlands and lowlands, written on paper of every hue, the pink, the violet, the white and the blue, the chatty, the catty, the boring, the adoring, the cold and official, and the hearts outpouring, clever, stupid, short and long, the typed and the printed and the spelt all wrong. Now the SVR has an impressive collection of locomotives and rolling stock, and quite apart from the showroom beasts in the Highley Engine House, you can get some idea of the extent of the collection as you peer out of the train windows leaving Kidderminster, where extensive sidings and sheds are home to rolling stock of all types, including restored diesels, as well as carriage sets of recent history, well, recent to those of my age anyway. And then as you approach Bewdley, more sidings with goods wagons of all types, sizes and configurations, and then glimpses of what you assume are working wagons alongside the track, with spare rails and other railway bits sitting on them. At the other stations, the spare track is taken up with what appear to be restoration projects yet to happen, and rolling towards Bridge North, a train of wagons built to carry coal, or more likely ballast stone for track laying, slide past the windows, and it dawns upon you that this is truly a working railway, with all it takes to keep it working now and in the future. And my mind goes back to when we lived in South Wales many years ago and took our children to see the railway graveyard, where rusting steam locomotives and rail stock sat, sometimes for years, even decades. And the children climbed on the derelict locos, many chalked with the name of some heritage railway which was raising the cash to recover them and restore them. The Severn Valley Railway is one of the end results of that massive attempt to claw back our railway history. It's a true gem of the British railway heritage, and an honest and exciting reflection of an era that could so easily have been lost. And that explains why we bought a ticket to ride the rails of the SVR.